verse 7. James chapter 4, verse 7. It's really a short phrase, sentence here, and I'm just going to go right into it. James chapter 4, verse 7, and it reads this. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. You may take your seats. My theme for this morning is submitting to authority. Submitting to authority. Now, most pastors will say, you know, you write that sermon during the week, and by the time you get to Sunday morning, the Lord will change it. And yeah, he did that. Amen. But praise the Lord. My original thoughts from this theme was dealing with something, but the Lord moved it, but we just going to move on to what thus saith the Lord. Submitting to authority. What does that look like? What does that require us to do? Submission. Let's look at the definition. Submission is the act or fact of accepting, yielding to a superior force or to the will or authority of another person. In this case, submission is accepting and yielding your members to the will of God. God placed us here on this earth to do his will, but one of the things he gave us ability to choose. We have the ability to choose to do his will or to do our own. Submission is the fact of accepting what God has said is true and to operate therein according to his will. We operate according to the laws of this land, and one of the things we find that is when people that are incarcerated, they are forced into submission because of the lack of voluntary submission to the laws of the land. So the Lord wants us to submit our lives unto him. How do we do that? Well, the Lord wants more than just lip service, but he requires action. I remember reading the scripture, and it said that their mouth, they honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. He said their hearts, their subconscious mind, their heart, the very thing that makes them do what they do is far from God. So the Lord wants us to submit. Submission to the Lord means everything. It means everything I say, everything I do will line up with his will. 1 John chapter 5, verse 2 says this. By this we know that we love the children of God when we love God and keep his commandments. Amen. For this is the love of God, that we keep his commandments, and his commandments are not grievous. His commandments are not hard. They're not something that's far-fetched. God did not tell us to go jump up a mountain. He didn't tell us to go, you know, he didn't tell us to do something crazy that was beyond what you are capable of doing. They're not grievous. He said, for whatsoever, verse 4, whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world, and this is the victory that overcometh the world, even our faith. So the victory we have that overcomes the world is based on our willingness to keep his commandments. So who is he that overcometh the world but he that believeth that Jesus is the Son of God? Do you believe that today? Do you believe he's the Son? Amen. So we submit ourselves to his commandments. In submission to his commandments, we resist the devil and overcome the world. Now, many of us make excuses of why it is not so that we are not submitted. We look at for the loophole in the gospel where we can no longer submit. Amen. We look for that excuse in this gospel. We say stuff like, I was submitted until the church until the pastor was caught in adultery. I was giving tithes until I found out that, you know, pastor kept buying all these new cars, so I quit tithing. I was submitted to my husband until I saw him making mistakes and I know I can do a better job. Then I knew it was time for me to take control of the situation. So I have to ask you, if you were submitted to the church, who were you serving? Why are you committed to a church and not the Lord? Your submission should be unto the Lord. If you were giving tithes and offering, who are you giving to? Tithes and offering belongs to God. Were you given to be seen of man? The word says, submit to your husband as unto the Lord. And I thought you were submitted unto the Lord and not your husband. Well, if you keep his commandments, you overcome the world. The world has some traps set along the way that if you walk according to the way of the world, the way the world operates, in walking in his commandments, then you will walk into a trap. If you keep moving the way the world say move, eventually you're going to find yourself ensnared. Whereas if you walk according to God's commandments, as you continue to walk in there, along that road, ain't nothing but blessings. Yes, the word tells us many are the afflictions of the righteous, but God delivers him from them all. God will deliver you from your afflictions, the things that you seem to be so overwhelming to you right now. Trust me. Paul said, I count it a light thing. It's a light thing. Let it go. Let it pass. It will pass. God wants us to submit unto his commandments and not make excuses of he is still working on me. That is the biggest excuse I hear today in church. Well, God is still working on me. God is not through with me yet. All these excuses of knowing the whole time, and you knowing the whole time, you make a conscious decision. You choose to walk contrary to his word. And the reason you do that is because of pride. God ain't still working on you. You aware of what you're doing. You just choose not to be submitted to the will of the Father. Submission. What are we to submit to? And I keep saying we are to submit to his commandments of the Lord. They are described in Exodus 20, and they start at verse 3. It says, you shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make of yourself any graven idol. You shall not take the Lord's name, thy God's name, in vain. It says to remember the Sabbath day and to keep it holy. It says for you to honor your father and your mother. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. Amen. All of these things are these commandments which God is talking about. But as I took from my theme in James chapter 4, let's go back in there and take a look at it again. It says in verse 3, ye ask and you receive not, because you ask amiss, that ye may consume it upon your lust. Ye adulterers and adulteresses, know ye that not that the friendship of the world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. Do you think that the scripture saith in vain, the spirit that dwelleth in us lusteth to envy? Don't you know what scripture says? I like the way this verse says it. He said, God wants to put his spirit into us, the spirit in us to belong to him. God calls his spirit to live in us. Don't you think the scripture has a reason for saying this? Verse 6, but he giveth more grace. Notice what he says. He giveth more grace. Wherefore he saith, God resisteth the proud. He resisted who? The proud, but giveth grace unto the humble. Who are the humble? Those who are submitted to God. Now I want you to understand something. There's something significant about these Ten Commandments that really stood out to me. See, the number five, it symbolizes God's grace, his goodness, and his favor towards us. Five is the number of grace, and multiplied by itself, which is 25, which is grace upon grace. And John, St. John chapter 1, verse 16, it says, we have all received from his fullness grace upon grace. So every time you extend grace, grace is multiplied into your account to receive grace 25 more times. Amen? So he says he gives you grace upon grace. Amen? And he multiplies it as it's extended unto you. The Ten Commandments, it contains two sets of five commandments. The first five commandments are related to our treatment and relationship with God. The last five, concern our relationship with humans, with one another. Those last five commandments. They said, but he giveth more grace, wherefore he said, God resisted the proud, but giveth grace to the humble. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God, resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Draw nigh to God, and he will draw nigh unto you. Cleanse your hands, ye sinners, and purify your hearts, ye double-minded. Be afflicted and mourn and weep. Let your laughter be turned to mourning and your joy to heaviness. Humble yourselves in the sight of the Lord, and he shall lift you up. Amen. That was James chapter 4. And it said, we all must submit to divine order. Jesus is submitted unto God the Father. Husbands are submitted unto Jesus. Man is submitted unto Jesus. Wives are submitted unto their husbands. Children are submitted unto their mother and father. And if you work, you must do, and most of us do, we are submitted unto the leaders of the job. Students must submit to teachers. We all have to submit to the laws of the land. And I just want to tell you, God has me dealing with these commandments in this hour, in this day, because his commandments are not grievous. His commandments are not hard, but we just got to have a heart to do them. Amen. Last week I had an opportunity to talk to you about the Sabbath day, which was one of the commandments dealing with how we reverence God. And this week I'm going to talk with one of the commandments of how we reverence man. He said, thou shalt not steal. Amen. Okay, let's look at that. Stealing, we know it's not correct. We not only know it, we've been knowing it since we was a child, but most of us have done it. I'm not saying everybody have took that piece of candy off the store shelf and hid it in mama's basket, or, you know, put it in the pocket and walked out the store, whatever. But, you know, we notice that. I want you to pay attention to the action here. We know it's not correct, but we did it. So I'm going to put aside the eye. We took it, we hid it, and we escaped with it. Notice, took, hid, and escaped. Now, stealing is to take another person's property without permission, or to take another person's property not having the legal right to attain it without intending to return it. So when you took that candy bar, when you took that sucker, or when you took that glow-in-the-dark glasses thing, whatever it was, you had no intention of returning it, but you know you took it because you grabbed it and you hid it. Excuse me. And you grabbed it and you hid it. So when you hid it, now I'll tell you something right there. I'm going to put a side note right here. For the Christians, anything that you must hide what you are doing or what you have done, there's a 99.9% chance it's not right in the eyes of the Lord either. And it's probably sin. There's a 99% 0.9999999 infinite percent chance this is sin. Why? Because there is nothing hidden in God. Amen. Amen. That's the definition is pretty cut and dry. So let's get a little deeper. To purchase property that you know was stolen. Okay. We didn't steal it, but we buying something somebody else stole. Now see, I can only talk about me. I learned my lesson from that one years ago. I think it was 1989, to tell you the truth. I was working at a service station at the gas station and working a night shift. This guy rolls in and he tells me he has VHS players for sale. Got them on sale. Y'all remember the VHS players, you know? I'm telling my age. But he had them for sale, brand new, still in the box. I said, okay. He told me it was, I can't remember, it was $50, $75, something like that. But anyway, I gave him the money. I took the box, put it in my car, you know, steel box, steel sealed. I'm like, yeah. I get home, I open the box of bricks. Box of bricks. I said, okay. So it sounded like it was a good deal. It sounded like I was going to gain from it, but neither did I know I was stolen from trying to buy ill-gotten gain. Okay? So he was a thief, and my sin was about to, because I was going to partake in that ill-gotten gain. And you know, $50, $75, you might not say it wasn't a lot, but in 1989, 50, that was a lot of money. My two-bedroom apartment rent was $350, so I lost, you know, part of that rent money right there buying the VCR. That's the name of it, VCR, VHS player. The Lord, I want you to pay attention. I believe one of the reasons that the church do these things is because we can ask for forgiveness and there is no consequences. And we think there is no consequences. I have to beg to differ on that. There's a consequence for every action that we take, and I want to highlight some of these things so that we don't think that we can do some of these things and come ask for forgiveness and it's gone. No, that's not how it works in the gospel. That's not how it works in the kingdom. You cannot run around with Sally's husband, Sarah's husband, and everybody else's husband and think God gonna bring you one. It ain't happening. It starts with repentance. Let me break it down for you. The Lord was not specific in how curses would come because of a single transgression, but he said in Deuteronomy 28:15, but it will happen if you will not listen to the voice of the Lord your God by being careful to do all his commandments. See, God grouped it all into one. He said all his commandments and his statutes, which I am commanding you today, that all these curses will come upon you and overtake you. Now, from Deuteronomy 28, verse 15 to verse 20, is the general curses. You will be cursed in the field, you'll be cursed coming in, you'll be cursed going out. But in verse 20, he gets a little more specific. He said, the Lord will send cursing, vexation, and rebuke on you in all that you set your hand to do. That stood out to me. Until you are destroyed and until you perish quickly because of the wickedness of your doings by which you have forsaken me. I'm sorry. I do not need the Lord trying to tear up everything I set my hand to do because I decided to partake in some stolen goods. And we do that. I got to warn you, church. Get them bootleg DVDs out your house. You're stealing. You don't look at it as stealing, but it's stealing. Get it out of your house. Verse 29. I want to break it down to Deuteronomy 28. Part B of verse 29 says this. And you will not prosper in your ways. You will only be oppressed continually, robbed, and no man will save you. Now, this. Look at this. He says, and you will not prosper in your ways. You will only be oppressed and continually robbed, and no man will save you. Now, I don't know what that sounds like to you, but to me, that sounds like the hood. Amen. It sounds just like the hood. You're oppressed. Let's tell the truth. If you call the cops, they don't come. People break in your house while you at work. Your car always broke down. You lose your bus pass. You get robbed on the train, the bus, coming home, going to work. Or you may not be violating God's law now because you don't have the strength of your youth, but back in the day, you did. Now, so you've got these curses operating around you because you chose to steal and violate the commandments of God. I want you to come out of this situation. I want the body of Christ to come out of these situations. If you want to come out from around these curses operating in your life, it starts with repentance. We want to stick our heads out of the sand, stick our heads in the sand, and act as if this is not a reason these things are happening the way they are. But I'm here to tell you, this is the full reason why these things are happening. You have, it just totally described it to you. You're oppressed, you're continually robbed, and no man will help you. You're not prospering in your ways. We know, excuse me, we know we're God's people. And with the things going on today, and these different movements, we better get back right with Him as a people, because we're God's people. God's people, our ancestors has never defeated an enemy when we were outside of His will. Amen. Submission is crucial to the survival of your children and their children's children. They only act like what they have seen their parents do. We are in these oppressed situations. Now I thank God for all the people that are making it out. Yes, there's a lot of people coming up. Yeah, and then they say, well, you won't buy nothing. No, it ain't got nothing to do with the color of your skin. The hood is the hood. You know, I'm sorry, you ain't working in my house. If I made it out, I thank God He brought me out. But that don't mean I'm supposed to live there and allow you to devour what God blessed me with. I'm sorry. I'm moving. And until you change your mind, you need to stay there. Amen. Look, you got a problem with it? Talk to the author of the book. Amen. It's crucial. Submission is crucial. The kingdom is multiplied from generation to generation. When God brought the children of Israel out of Egypt, they were blessed. He has brought us out of the form of Egypt, and the blessings are there. But we have been fooled again, just like Balaam fooled our forefathers, and 24,000 of them died in the wilderness. What do you mean? What do you mean we're fooled like Balaam? Well, Balaam, if you remember in the story of Numbers 22, Balak the king called for Balaam to curse the children of Israel. But he could not curse them because God called them blessed. So what he got the children of Israel to do is he got them to sin against their God. And then God vexed them. He killed, that's how the 24,000 of them got, they got killed because, not because Balaam came to curse them, they got killed because they was worshiping other gods. We are getting destroyed today. Let me explain this to you. In state prisons, African Americans are incarcerated at 5-1. To the rates of whites. There's 5 states, Iowa, Minnesota, New Jersey, Vermont, and Wisconsin, have a disparity of more than 10-1 incarcerations. African Americans. 12 states have prison populations that are more than half black. Alabama, Delaware, Georgia, Illinois, Louisiana, Maryland, Michigan, Mississippi, New Jersey, North Carolina, South Carolina, and Virginia. More than half the population is more than black. More than 50% of their population is black. Maryland has a prison population that is 72% black. In 11 states, at least 1 in 20 adults, African American men, is in prison. In Oklahoma, it is 1 in 15. Latinos are incarcerated at 1 in 4 times the rates of whites. This, now check this out. The study cites 3 major reasons for disparity. Policies and practice of such harsh sentences on drug-related crimes that are disproportionately affect African Americans. Implicit racial biases that affect judges, and look at this last one. And the structural disadvantages that affect African Americans before they enter the criminal justice system. The structural disadvantages are the curses that are operating in the hood. It's because we refuse to submit to God, these things are happening. Part B, and you will not prosper in your ways, and you will only be oppressed and continually robbed, and no man will save you. If you want to be real, submit yourselves therefore to God. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. Their submission has to take place. There has to be a submission. If you're not violating one of God's laws, they have no reason to violate you. Amen. If you're not into trickery and thievery and doing things that God did not say do, you will not find yourself incarcerated. You will not find yourself locked up or any of these things. The only reason it is happening is because you refuse to submit to the authority of God. Yes, there's some things that's happening, but you wouldn't even come up before a court system if you was walking rightly with God. So I have to tell you, I have to warn you, I have to say this, because when you got over, I think it was like 3.1 million that were incarcerated in 2016 total, and you got states like the numbers I just described, you're not ready. We're incarcerated because of our lack of submission. Well, I'm hard, I'm tough, I'm strong. No, you ain't. You want to be tough, you want to be hard, try walking this gospel. Try doing the things God said do. You know, they want to make this, let me tell you something. Walking this gospel, you look. I had a friend of mine tell me one time, he said, Lorenzo, he said, getting old ain't for punks. And I'm going to tell you this, walking this gospel ain't for punks. You want to be a man, you want to be a real man, try walking this gospel. Try doing what God say do and see how tough you really are. See, we think our strength lies in our physical ability, it lies in our muscle, it lies in our wittingness, our wittiness. No, your strength lies in your willingness to be humble to God. If you're willing to walk in his commandments and keep his statutes, not only will the blessings come, but his favor be upon your life. And you will come out from all those trials and tribulations and all the things that you face. And I tell the young people that are born in these situations called the hood, and you wondering why you are here, it's because of your forefathers, but you don't have to stay. You can come out by submitting yourselves unto God. Submit unto him. Resist the devil, and he will flee from you. He'll flee from you. Shall we stand? If there's anybody here today that needs to submit, if anybody is watching me online that needs to submit their ways unto God, walk in his commandments. They're not hard. They're not grievous. It's not something that's rocket science. It's simple. It's plain. It's faith-based. It's do the best you can. Allow God to use you. Amen. Father, we just thank you right now for what you're doing in this house. We thank you for this word today. Father, bring us to a place of submission in you. Father, that we may resist the devil, oh God, and let him flee, oh Lord, in the name of Jesus. Father, we know that when we're submitted to you, you become our shelter. You become our hiding place. You become our shield and our buckler, oh God. It is you who go before us. It is you who goes to face the nations before us, God, because we are submitted unto you. So we thank you this day, Lord, that you have given each one of us a heart to submit and a heart to do your will. So we bless you and honor you. In your Son Jesus' name we pray. Amen.